Okay, so Isaiah 61. Isaiah was a prophet, and he was looking forward to the coming of the Messiah. And in this passage, he's talking about what will happen when the Messiah comes. We know in advance the Messiah is Jesus. Verse 10, Isaiah 61, 10. I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My whole being shall exalt in my God. That's what's going to happen. And then one of the metaphors he uses is the metaphor of a wedding. So he's saying, I will greatly rejoice. That day I'll be so happy. And then he's explaining what's going to happen, and he talks about a wedding. For he has clothed me with the garments of salvation. He has covered me with the robe of righteousness, as a bridegroom decks himself with a garland, and as a bride adorns herself with jewels. So the metaphor of the Messiah's coming, one way to think about it is like a wedding. And I planned a wedding not too long ago. A lot of people in this church have planned weddings for themselves, for their kids. So there's, I think, some traction here. And if you've ever been involved in wedding planning, it is a lot of preparation. You have a lot of decisions to make and many tasks to do. You also have a lot to worry about, a lot that you can worry about. If you want to, you can worry about whether you chose the correct one out of 40 tablecloth colors that were available. You can worry about that if you want. And of course, in the midst of all of that, there's excitement and anticipation. But there's also a lot of worry, right? Did we pick the right tablecloth color? And the tablecloths, those are the least of your concern. Let's talk about the dress. In our case, we bought a beautiful dress. Caitlin's mother and her went shopping and bought a beautiful dress, and it had to be tailored. And so we took it to this one tailor, and they were bad, and they didn't know how to sew. So I said, a tailor needs to know how to sew. So we asked around, and thanks to the people from this church, we were able to find a good tailor, and we sent it in. But you can worry about that dress. Even I was worried about my suit, because it turned out I had actually, you might not believe this, but I had gained 20 pounds since when I bought my suit. And so the pants, I could kind of suck in and wear them, but they would not be suitable for dancing. And so those were some of the things that we worried about. What are we going to wear? And it's very easy when you're planning a wedding to get consumed with worrying about the tasks that have to be done. What am I going to wear? Is the dress going to be done? How many buttons is it going to have? Are they going to be crystal buttons? Are they going to be silk buttons? And suddenly the wedding becomes all about that. All about making decisions and having plans set. And I can just tell you from my experience, when the day finally comes, you're a nervous wreck. And it's not because I'm worried that I found God's match for me. That I know. But it's like, is everything going to go according to plan? But when I stood here, and as soon as Caitlin walked in, dressed in a dress that turned out great, suddenly it was like a wall went up in my mind, and I remembered exactly what this day was all about. I totally forgot everything else. And the only thing that I could focus on was, right, I am here to marry Caitlin. That's what this is all about. And just for that moment, there's only one thing that matters, which is the presence of the other person. It took a lot of work to get here. And if we're going to be married for any length of time, it's going to take a lot more work from this moment forward. But right now, the work is done. We're here together. That's what's important. That's the Christmas moment, right? God gave us work to do. He wants us to prepare for his coming. He wants us to follow him. There's lots of work to do. But at Christmas, we remember the work is done. Jesus is here. God came. He's among us. Let's just be with him. Let's enjoy him. It's one of the things that they tell you, the wise people tell you when you get married is, on your wedding day, remember to actually pay attention. Remember to be there. Remember to enjoy it, because you will forget to enjoy it, and you'll think about the next thing, but be right there. And that's what we need to do with God. How do we be right there with God instead of worrying about the next thing, worrying about the work that has to be done. How are we going to keep our church open? How are we going to preach the right way? How are my kids going to believe? How am I going to do? And you might know me. I'm somebody who worries about that stuff. How do you just sit there with God? Like on a wedding day. Isaiah is going to give us a clue in this in the next metaphor. He says, "For as the earth brings forth its shoots, and as a garden causes what is sown in it to spring up, so the Lord God will cause righteousness and praise to spring up before all the nations." So now the coming of the Messiah is like a garden. We're going to shift our imagery here. And if you know anything about gardens, I don't know, gardens might be more work than weddings. It's a toss-up. You have to till the soil, you have to plant the seeds, you have to choose the right seeds, you have to water them, plant them at the right time, care for them, keep the animals away. You have to wait a long time. The seeds stay in the ground without blossoming, or without even putting forth a little green nug, for a long time. You have nothing to show for your work for a lot of the time that you're a gardener. But then, of course, it finally blooms. The green little shoot comes out of the ground, and it grows, and big, red, juicy tomatoes start hanging there, and flowers open up, and there's color, and it's beautiful. I mean, it is. It's beautiful. That's the whole point of a garden. And a wise gardener knows that there's more work to do once the garden's bloomed. Right? I remember my third grade teacher said, Alex Rodriguez, the Yankee player, doesn't just go to spring training and then never practice the rest of the year. That's not how it works. You know, that's not how a garden works. You don't just grow it and then keep it. So a wise gardener knows that. There's going to be a lot more work. But if you're a really wise gardener, you don't worry about that right away. You go and sit in your garden and you look at it and say, wow, I made something really beautiful. This is really nice. And you just enjoy it for a little bit. You appreciate what your work has accomplished. And just be satisfied with what you've made. I think one of the great tragedies, however, of gardening, which I have limited experience in, is that as far as I know, you know, I go out there, I plant just a few tomato plants. And I appreciate the plants, and I, you know, take the tomatoes and I eat them, and they're yummy. The tragedy is that the tomatoes can't appreciate me. I worked hard to bring you to life, you little tomato, and you're so beautiful. But the tomato doesn't know how much I love him. But we can appreciate our gardener. Because God is the gardener, and we are the plants. God's people are the plants of his garden. And he spent actually an eternity planning out his garden, sowing seeds and tending it. So he chose his people. He chose the right seed of Abraham. He brought them out of Egypt. He literally gave them food and water in the desert, and he also fed them spiritually by giving them the law and the prophets and instruction in righteousness. And now, he sends his people Jesus Christ, and it's time for the garden to bloom after being fed and nurtured and cared for and watered and planned for so long. So we are like seeds planted in the ground. But we're no longer waiting to pop up and be alive and be fruitful. The time has come. God has caused us to spring up. And the neat thing is, we open our eyes like a flower opens its eyes, and God's right there, right in front of us. Boom. No waiting. Our job now is to enjoy him, to do what the tomatoes can't do. Their gardener is enjoying us. And we can enjoy him. How? And Isaiah gives us one more clue here. As a garden causes what is sown in it to spring up, so the Lord God will cause righteousness and praise to spring up before all the nations. That's the fruit of the garden, is righteousness and praise. So we'll talk just quickly what righteousness means. Righteousness means we were ugly and sinful, but Jesus came and as the Messiah made us pretty. He decked us in a garment of righteousness is the language from the marriage metaphor. So now we're no longer messed up. That's not something that you have to worry about. Am I doing things right? Is my life on track? You know, take some time where you're not worrying about that and just saying, wait, Jesus died. I'm righteous. When God looks at me, he says, that's a beautiful person. That's what God thinks when he looks at you like a gardener looks at their garden, like a husband looks at his wife, or a wife looks at her husband, says, wow, the person is beautiful. That's what God says when he looks at his people. Because he's made us righteous. And the only thing we can do is turn around and, what does it say? He will cause righteousness and praise to spring up before all the nations. God made us beautiful like a garden, like I make the most beautiful tomatoes. It helps that Genia Lazda gives me the best seeds. But I do some work and I make the most beautiful tomatoes that grow at 205 Hampton Road. And those tomatoes just sitting there and being delicious and big and red, actually, they can't appreciate me, but they can praise me, because anytime anybody sees those tomatoes and says, wow, those are beautiful, I get the credit, because the tomatoes didn't grow themselves. I grew them. And so tomatoes are really good. Tomatoes are not sinful, so they don't do things like try to flaunt themselves and say, no, I don't know what tomato could ever say in its defense that it did any work, but they don't do that. And God's asking us, if you really want to enjoy me, that's how you do it. First of all, just accept that I look at you and I've made you righteous and I say that you're beautiful. And then go just be the beautiful person that I have made again in Christ. Just sit there and be that person in the world. And people will walk by and say, wow, what's up with that person? And their attention will go directly to God. That's why it says, this is Isaiah 62:3, you shall be a crown of beauty in the hand of the Lord, and a royal diadem in the hand of your God. In other words, a beautiful symbol of God's power and authority and love and care. That's what we are. And God holds us out like a king would hold out a scepter or a crown and just says, look at how great this is. And everybody who looks at it says, what a beautiful thing. What a beautiful God must have made that thing. You shall be a crown of beauty in the hand of the Lord and a royal diadem in the hand of your God. Let God love you. Let God say that you're beautiful. Listen to God say that you are beautiful, and know that when you are being who God has called you to be, the world says, wow, wow, God must be amazing. And you can actually let other people enjoy God too. I just want to get a little more practical before we conclude. Galatians 4:4-7, because I'll be honest, I have a lot of trouble with this. This is my idea of enjoying God. Wake up at 6, throw the covers off the bed, jump onto the cold floor, immediately get my suit on, and run to church and sit there and work as hard as I can all day, because I gotta do work for God. How am I gonna enjoy, how's anybody ever gonna enjoy God if I don't be an awesome pastor? Right? How are my kids ever gonna enjoy God if I'm not a perfect parent all the time? Well, That's the struggle. At least that's my struggle, if I'm being honest with you. Not to just sit there and enjoy the wedding, but to say, okay, you know, is there going to be a vegan option for our friend at the reception? You know, is the dress done? Is that stitch going to fall out of the dress? That's always the temptation. How do we avoid that? Galatians 4:4-7 gives us a little bit of help. But when the fullness of time had come, God sent his son, born of a woman, born under the law, in order to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as children. And because you are children, God has sent the Spirit of his Son into you, crying, what? Abba, Father. So you are no longer a slave, but a child. And if a child, then also an heir through God. There's a big difference between being a slave and being a child. A slave has to do as much work as they possibly can, or else they're out. A child can do as little work as they possibly can and still be in. And God says we're not slaves. We are children. The work is done. The Father does the work. We live in the house with the Father. That doesn't mean that you don't have to do your chores, but we'll talk about that later. Right now, we're talking about God is our Father, and we're the children who live in His house. The most important thing we can do, that God has sent the Spirit of His own Son in us, according to Galatians, to do, is just to cry out, Abba, Father, just to call God Father, just to say to God, I give up. I can't really do anything. I'm a tomato. You planted me. You watered me. You made me beautiful, and you love me. It's my wedding day. The work is done. I'm just standing here and waiting for you. I'm a child in your house. You're my Father. I trust you. I'm satisfied in you. I'm just going to enjoy the fact that you love me. That's all I have to do. If that's all you have to do, then you can enjoy God and give glory to Him. Amen. If you'd like to enjoy God and know that the coming of the Messiah, Jesus Christ, is the sign and the accomplishment of God's presence with us, then I'd invite you to stand. And together we will proclaim our faith in Him. And in so doing, proclaim that we are ready to let God do the work, to let God be the Father and the gardener of our lives, and be the most beautiful little tomatoes in His garden. Let's read together. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government will be upon His shoulder. And His name is called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of His government and peace, there will be no end upon the throne of David and over His kingdom, to order it and establish it with judgment and justice from that time forward, even forever. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this.